Good morning. Magandang umaga po sa inyong lahat. Well, it is truly a blessing that we can come together in worship and now in the study of God's Word. And like what JC said a while ago, nandito na tayo sa chapter 2. Now we will be opening up chapter 2 and I will be coursing through verses 1 up to verse 5. And the title of my message for this morning is The Wedding at Cana. Now, if you still remember, at the start of this year, when we opened up this series on John, I said that the author, sino yung author? Si John, di ba? John the Apostle. He wants to make sure that as we go through every chapter of this gospel, in every life of the Lord Jesus Christ, every part of his life, in every miracle that he performed, he wants us to know that this is a testament of his, not only of his humanity, but more so of his deity. That Jesus is indeed God in human flesh. And for almost 2 months, we learned from chapter 1, verses 1 to 18, of the attributes of our Lord Jesus Christ, that he is indeed the true Messiah. We talked about his pre-existence, him being God, his being the source of life, being the light of men, and let's not forget about also of his condescension when he took on humanity in the form of a slave. And all of this for the purpose of what? For the purpose of redeeming us, for the purpose of our salvation. And after that introduction, we saw the first-hand account of the voice crying in the wilderness. Sino yun? John the Baptist. He was testifying about the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Now people were actually already swarming around him because they heard that he was indeed a prophet. And because of that, the Levites and the priests sent people to ask him if he was indeed the Messiah. And what was his answer? He quickly denied it. Sabi niya, hindi ako ang Kristo. But you know what? Instead, he took that occasion as an opportunity to share the Lord Jesus Christ, to declare about the Messiah. And after baptizing the Messiah and presenting him as the Lamb of God, what the baptizer did now was to point his own disciples to the direction of the true Messiah King, to the direction of the Lamb of God. And in the last 4 Sundays, we have seen how the disciples, John, Andrew, Philip, or Peter, Philip, and Nathaniel, were brought to the Lord Jesus Christ and how they responded to his calling. And it is from here that we pick up our message for today. And as we now embark on the next chapter, we will now take a look at the very first miracle that Jesus performed. Though I will be dealing only partly of that segment, because I will be going through the first 5 verses of this narrative. But again, for context's sake, let me read to you the whole part of that event, that miracle, which occurred at the wedding in Cana. So may I request everyone to please rise and let us honor God through the reading of his words. Let me read to you John chapter 2, verses 1 up to verse 12. Now on the third day, there was a wedding in Cana of Galilee, and the mother of Jesus was there. And both Jesus and his disciples were invited to the wedding. When the wine ran out, the mother of Jesus said to him, "They have no wine." And Jesus said to her, "Woman, what does that have to do with us? My hour has not yet come." His mother said to his servants, "Whatever he says to you, do it." Now there were 6 stone water pots set there for the Jewish custom of purification, containing 20 or 30 gallons each. Jesus said to them, "Fill the water pots with water." So they filled them up to the brim. And he said to them, "Draw some out now and take it to the head waiter." So they took it to him. When the head waiter tasted the water, which had become wine, and did not know where it came from, but the servants who had drawn the water knew, the head waiter called the bridegroom and said to him, "Every man serves a good wine first, And when the people have drunk freely, then he serves the poorer wine. But you have kept the good wine until now. This beginning of his signs Jesus did in Cana of Galilee, and manifested his glory, and his disciples believed in him. After this, he went down to Capernaum, he and his mother and his brothers and his disciples, and they stayed there for a few days. Let us pray. Our dear Heavenly Father, thank you for again blessing us with your truth this morning. And as we come before your throne of grace, we ask, O Lord, that you give us hearts that are indeed receptive to your words, hearts that are indeed attuned to your will. Lord, unworthy as we are truly grateful for the sacrifice that you did for all of us through our Lord Jesus Christ. Forgive us, O Lord, for our unfaithfulness. Forgive us that we seem to give more time to things that are non-essential or of no importance at all, rather than spending time with you. Thank you, dear Father, that even through our unfaithfulness, still you have worked your will in us. Indeed, you are our sovereign and almighty God, our gracious and loving Father. That is why we come to you right now, O Lord, asking you to take away anything that would distract us from focusing on you and on your words. Will you take our hearts and our thoughts captive, dear Father, that we might only see you and hear you as we listen to the preaching of your word this morning. Father, will you now enable me and empower me through your Holy Spirit, that I may speak forth of your truth with boldness and authority. Thank you once again, Father, for giving us this time. Will you bless us even now? In Christ's name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. 3 points: the setting, the setback, and the solution. Now, I didn't ask the permission of my son on this, pero nandito na, ikikwento ko na lang. No? Pero hindi naman mapapahiya yung anak ko dito. You see, my eldest son, G, attended a wedding last year sa Iloilo. And the wedding had, I think, around 1,000 guests. No? And that wedding actually was a wedding of a friend, not only his friend, but also our friends, a colleague in our business also. Now, it's a good thing that they own a chain of hotels in that area, because I think almost half of the guests were flying in from Manila, and they have to take care of all of their accommodations. Now, my son was actually requested also to help out in the event on the technical side of it. But even if they already had hired a team to take care of that. Pero if you see the vastness of that place, and because they want to make sure that every single guest would be able to see and hear the event, the every detail of that event, kinausap nila si G to help out. And what as I was going through this lesson, pumasok sa isip ko, sabi ko, one glitch or one neglect, no, in this event, and that could spell disaster. Like, for example, if Meralco decides to have a brownout on that time and on that date and time, no, disaster yan. But of course, I'm sure they have backup power, no? And that would be definitely a disaster. But you know what, besides that, feeding 1,000 guests, I think that is more toiling. No, you feed 1,000 guests continuously, making sure that your food and the drinks will last up to the last minute of that event. That would definitely be a toiling work for all of them. Pero isipin nyo, paano kaya kung ang nangyari, inaubusan ng pagkain? You know what? probably if there was no power, magkaroon ng brownout, that would be okay. That would be okay kasi hindi nila control eh. But what if naubusan ng pagkain? That is another story. Hindi na mabaling mawalan ng kuryente, huwag lang mawalan ng pagkain. Ibang usapan yan. And I can't help but think about that as I studied our main text for today. And in a couple of minutes, we will talk about the setback or the predicament that was presented before the Lord Jesus Christ by Mary. And what was the predicament as we read through the text for today? They ran out of wine. Naubusan sila ng alak. Now, if you think this is an issue about whether it is okay to drink or not to drink wine, well, sorry to disappoint you, hindi po yan ang pag-uusapan natin. Because the passage does not talk about that. What the passage talks about is launching the Lord Jesus Christ into public ministry. That is what we are going to go through this morning. That will be the main focus of our text for today. And God willing, we will be able to see the significance of this event in our lives as Christians. Sana makuha natin yun. Sana maintindihan natin yun. But before we jump into this predicament, let us go first to the setting or the scenario of this watershed moment in the life of our Lord Jesus Christ. And let me read to you John chapter 2, again, verses 1 to 2. On the third day, there was a wedding in Cana of Galilee, and the mother of Jesus was there, and both Jesus and his disciples were invited to the wedding. This is the setting. Ang sabi dyan, on the third day. It was almost 3 days after Jesus decided to go to Galilee, and along the way, based on last Sunday's passage, he found Philip and Nathanael. And now after that, on the third day, he was at the wedding at Cana. Now Cana, which is now known as Kirbet Cana, is more than 100 kilometers away from Bethany near the Jordan River, where the Lord Jesus Christ was baptized by John the Baptist. If you look at the map on your screen, you would see that Cana is on the northwest side of Israel. Yung Bethany and the Jordan River, nasa bandang baba. And that probably explained why it took them almost 3 days to arrive at the wedding at Cana. And incidentally, Nathanael was from Cana also. You can see that in John 21 verse 2. Now, during the time of Christ, one of the most awaited festivities or celebration is the wedding of a townfolk or a townmate. During the time of Christ, the inhabitants of Cana was believed to be not more than 300. Maliit na baryo lamang ito. It is a small town. And that is why every wedding was basically a town celebration or a town festivity. And probably that is the reason why they were celebrating this festivity for a longer period of time also. You see, during the time of Christ, they were celebrating these kind of events, not only for 3 days, not only for 7 days, but for almost even up to 10 days. And if you'd compare this to us also in our context, we also do that. If you go to the provinces, sa mga barrios, ilang araw ba ang ginagawa pag may kasalan? No. I searched it through Google, yun sa akin 3 days eh. Up to 3 days. But Pastor Dennis, the last time, said, even up to 7 days inaabot din. You see the preparation that they have to do for that long period of time and the number of guests that they need to prepare for these kind of festivities. It is toiling. A lot of work, a lot of preparations. They have to make sure that the food and the wine would be overflowing and it would last until the last guest would have left. That is the way they prepare this kind of festivities. And you know what? For the wine to run out, this is actually a, what you call a disaster. It is a disaster. It is catastrophic, no? It is catastrophic. Why? Because this would definitely embarrass the bridegroom and his immediate family. Now, going back to verse 1, Mary, though her name was not mentioned here, but was identified as the mother of Jesus, was there at the wedding. Now, there were speculations that Mary was probably a relative of the bridegroom, or even both parties. Because when the wine ran out, she was one of the first people to know about that and was really concerned about that predicament. Now, one thing that you would notice here was that the name of Joseph was never mentioned, Mary's husband. Joseph was never mentioned in this gospel. Why? Because it was believed that about this time, around this time, Joseph was already dead. He had already died. He was already non-existent when Jesus began his public ministry. And going to verse 2, besides Mary, Jesus and his disciples were also there at the wedding. Who were his disciples then? Andrew, Peter, Philip, and Nathanael, and the nameless disciple. And who was that? John. John the apostle, the author, John the beloved. And for Jesus to grace that wedding shows us that he puts importance in this kind of ceremony, in the sanctity of marriage. It solicited not only the honor of his presence, but it was also here that he performed his first miracle. Marriage, you see, was instituted by God. And it was through the marriage of a husband and wife that the relationship of Christ and his church was likened to. If you go to Ephesians chapter 5, verse 23 to 25, it says this: For the husband is the head of the wife, as Christ also is the head of the church. He himself being the savior of the body, but as the church is subject to Christ, so also the wives ought to be to their husbands in everything. Husbands, love your wives, just as Christ also loved the church and gave himself up for her. And therefore we have to honor marriage the way our Savior did, because it represents the union of Christ and his church. Like what Jesus said in Matthew 19, what God has joined together, let no man separate. And therefore, there should be no divorce. That was the setting. Yun yung scenario, the wedding at Cana. One other point that is noteworthy before we go to our next point is that unlike John the Baptist, who lived in the wilderness and would shy away from events or feasts like this or gatherings like this, and whose diet is only what? Honey and locusts, diba? Jesus, on the other hand, would enjoin himself in these celebrations. Not necessarily to eat, drink, and be merry, but it was for the purpose of fulfilling his mission, which is what? To seek and save the lost. Let us now go to our next point in verse 3. When the wine ran out, the mother of Jesus said to him, "They have no wine." This is the setback. This is the predicament. Ito yung problema. Again, you see, during the time of Christ, wine was the staple drink in any celebration. Fermented wine was usually mixed with water from 1:3 to as low as to 1:10. And this is the reason why they can drink as many as they can and still not get drunk. Drunkenness, I think you all know, was a sin to the Jew, much more so to us as Christians. And again, like what I said, I won't get into that discussion of whether to drink or not to drink. Baka si Pastor Dennis, daanan niya yan. Because that is not the issue at hand. What is the issue? They ran out of wine. Naubusan sila ng wine. Ano ba yung wine sa Tagalog? Alak eh, no? Naubusan sila ng alak. So let us just stick to that issue. Now going back to the setback, going back to the predicament, for Mary to be concerned with the wine running out could only mean that probably she is indeed one of the relatives, and probably she was also one of the volunteers helping out in that celebration. And the wine did run out. And what comes first to the mind of Mary was to go straight to her son, the Lord Jesus, and tell him about the predicament. Like what I said a while ago, folks, for the feast to run out of wine, this is a disaster, a social disaster. It is an embarrassment of catastrophic range or proportions, especially to the bridegroom and to his family. Hindi biro yan. Kahihiyan ng buong pamilya nila yan. And since Mary was a relative, this became a concern for her as well. And just like any other mother would do, especially from a widow, she would turn to his children. And in this case, to the Lord Jesus Christ. This was the setback. This was the predicament. They ran out of wine. You see, my mom, who lives in Las Piñas, would often reach out to me whenever she needs things to be done inside her house. Or if she needs a ride going to Manila, or even as far as Bicol. Dun kasi yung kanyang hometown, Sanaga. And I would be the first one that she would go to. Being the eldest among a brood of five, naturally, I was the turn two guy. And I was the eldest as well. And I think this could also be the case of the Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus being the eldest among Mary's children, and his mom already a widow, siya talaga ang lalapitan ng kanyang ina. You see, there were actually speculations that the reason why Mary went to his son Jesus was because as a child, Jesus had already performed small miracles. To which I beg to disagree, because you wouldn't see that in the scriptures. Walang nakalagay sa Biblia that he did small miracles in the family. What was only said about the young Jesus was about his outstanding wisdom. His understanding of the scriptures according to Luke was really astonishing. If you go to Luke chapter 2 verse 41 to 49, it says here, "Now his parents went to Jerusalem every year at the feast of the Passover. Then when he became 12, they went up there according to the custom of the feast. And as they were returning, after spending the full number of days, the boy Jesus stayed behind in Jerusalem. But his parents were unaware of it, but supposed him to be in the caravan, and went a day's journey, and they began looking for him among their relatives and acquaintances. When they did not find him, they returned to Jerusalem looking for him. Then after 3 days, they found him in the temple, sitting in the midst of the teachers, both listening to them and asking them questions. And all who heard him were amazed at his understanding and his answers. When they saw him, they were astonished. And his mother said to him, 'Son, why have you treated us this way? Behold, your father and I have been anxiously looking for you.' And he said to them, 'Why is it that you were looking for me? Did you not know that I had to be in my father's house?'" You know what? At that moment, I'm sure people who heard Jesus speak, they would find it strange, but at the same time, they would be amazed with the way he understood scriptures, since he was then still a child at the age of 12. But you know what? I'm quite certain, especially for Mary, the mother of Jesus, these events were actually only confirmations of what the angel of God had told her, that she would conceive and bore the Messiah, the Lord Jesus Christ. But going back to what Jesus said, to what the young Jesus said in verse 49, clearly showed us that even at a young age, the Lord Jesus Christ already knew his purpose. He already knew the task that is being given to him by his Father. The reason why he was sent to this world, to earth. One more thing that I like to mention is the significance of Mary, of what Mary did when she presented the problem or the predicament to the Lord Jesus Christ and asked for his help. This only showed that Mary herself acknowledged that she needed the help of the Savior. She needed the help of the Lord Jesus Christ. Yun ang ibig sabihin nun, kung bakit siya lumapit sa Panginoong Jesus. You know what? To bow down and pray to Mary and believe that through her intercession, your prayers are going to be heard by Christ. You know what? This is so untrue and so unbiblical. Because if you go to Luke chapter 1, verse 46 to 47, Mary in her Magnificat acknowledged and declared that God was indeed her Savior. Verse 46 says, "My soul exalts the Lord, and my spirit has rejoiced in God, my Savior." That is a declaration of reliance on his Savior, on her Savior. That is a declaration of faith coming from Mary. And to call her the mother of God is really false and misleading. How can she be the mother of God when she calls her God her Savior? And to bestow the title Immaculate, this is truly deceptive and it is a lie. Because just like any one of us here, Mary is also a sinner and in need of a Savior. And you know what? Sadly, it is this passage in John that the Catholics would often use to claim that Mary was indeed a mediatrix to the Lord Jesus Christ. Ito yung ginagamit nilang passage. You know what? I had one encounter with one of my former employee regarding this issue, mga 20 years ago na yan. I was trying to share the gospel with him, but he was quite apprehensive and suspicious that I was trying to convert him, which is true. Yun naman talagang dahilan why I was sharing the gospel to him. And we had a long discussion because we were coming from Santa Cruz, Laguna and going back to Las Piñas. It was almost a heated discussion. And the only reason why it did not turn out that way is because I had to remind him time to time that I was his boss. Tandaan mo, boss mo ako. Now, one issue that was discussed about was the worship of Mary. Though he said that he doesn't worship Mary. Pero sabi niya, he admits to me that he bows down to Mary and even pray to Mary. And I asked him, why would you even pray to her if you say you don't worship her? And he said that the reason why he's doing that was because he wanted to make sure that his prayers are going to be heard by the Lord Jesus Christ. And because he wanted to make sure that I understand his point, he made a true-to-life analogy. Tagalogin ko na lang. Ito yung sabi niya sa akin noon. Sabi niya, "Boss, sabihin natin gusto kong bumali. Example lang yun, ha? Gusto kong bumali. Kaso nakita kong mainit ang ulo mo. Eh, alam nga naman, uutang ako sa iyo, tapos mainit ulo mo. Di siyempre, tatanggihan mo ako niyan. Kaya ang ginawa ko, nilapitan ko ang nanay mo at sinabi ko sa kanya, 'Ma'am, baka naman pwedeng kausapin mo si boss. Kailangan ko kasing bumali ng 500. Pag kayo kasi ang nakipag-usap, sigurado kayong pakikinggan ni boss. Tapos siyempre, boss, pag kinausap na kayo ng nanay niyo, alam naman tatanggihan niyo siya. Eh di siyempre, pababalihin niyo na ako ngayon.' Sagot ko sa kanya, 'Pabalik ka lang, idinaan mo pa sa kwento.' But you know, this is a true story. And I told him, 'Your story could probably be true. Pwera lang dun sa pababalihin kita ng 500. No? I said, that could be true, but not with the Lord Jesus Christ. For he said in Matthew 11:28, come to me, all you who are weary and heavy laden. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Diba? And learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart. You don't need a mediator to someone who is gentle and humble in heart. There is no such thing as a mediatrix to Christ. More so, a co-mediatrix to God. We were redeemed by only one man. We only have one mediator to God. And that is no other than the Lord Jesus Christ. And going to our last point in verses 4 and 5. Jesus said to her, woman, what does that have to do with us? My hour has not yet come. His mother said to the servants, whatever he says to you, do it. This is the solution. Now, let me ask this first to the husbands. Husbands, have you ever called your wives as woman? Nasubukan niyo na ba yun? What do you think will their reaction be? Wives, what will be your reaction? Boljak, gusto mo? Probably that would be your reaction. Is there a sense of disrespect? Para ba kayong binastos? Imagine now that your child calling you that. Tawagin ka ng anak mo. Babae. Woman. How would you react? Now, let me ask you this again. Was Jesus trying to disrespect her mother? Was he trying to do that, his mother? Was he trying to disrespect his mother? You see, the problem with the English translation is that sometimes we might translate or interpret it as if Jesus was being disrespectful or impolite. And that is why we have to go to the original text. And the Greek translation for woman is gune, which can only mean my lady or wife or even perhaps ma'am or madam. Sa Tagalog nga, ginang. This was also how Christ addressed Mary in his dying hours when he entrusted the care of Mary to John the Beloved. If you go to John chapter 19, verse 26 to 27, when Jesus then saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing nearby, he said to his mother, woman, behold your son. Then he said to the disciple, behold your mother. From that hour, the disciple took her into his own household. You know what? I truly believe there was no intention of disrespect to Mary when the Lord Jesus Christ called her woman. But it does seem like a mild rebuke coming from him. And you can also sense that Jesus was now trying to distance himself from Mary. When he said, what does that have to do with us? I like how the Pillar New Testament commentary translated it more objectively, wherein it says, what do you and I have in common so far as the matter at hand is concerned? Or even the NIV, which says, why do you involve me? Folks, you know what? This could probably be a declaration coming from the Lord Jesus Christ. A declaration that he is now embarking to do his father's business. When Jesus called her woman and not mother, actually signifies that his duty as a son to her has ended. He was actually separating himself from the mother and son relationship, because he is now taking on the responsibilities that his father, his heavenly father, had bestowed upon him. Him being the Son of God. One proof about that is if you go to Mark chapter 3 verse 31 to 35. It says here, then his mother and his brothers arrived, and standing outside, they sent word to him and called him. A crowd was sitting around him, and they said to him, behold, your mother and your brothers are outside looking for you. Answering them, he said, who are my mother and my brothers? Looking about at those who were sitting around him, he said, behold, my mother and my brothers. For whoever does the will of God, he is my brother and sister and mother. Mary's authority as a mother to her son has already ceased, because Jesus now has to fulfill his God-ordained mission of reconciling man to his Father. He is now geared towards fulfilling this mission his Father had tasked him to do. And Mary understood that. Naintindihan niya ni Maria. And that is why she was not offended when Jesus called her woman. She knows in her heart that this day would come, that she has to let him go and fulfill his mission. And that is why, even with that kind of a statement, whether we think it was just an idiomatic expression or a slight rebuke coming from Jesus, Mary was never offended by it. She was never offended by it. But you know what? Instead, she took that into her heart. And going back to verse 4, Jesus also said, my hour has not yet come. My hour has not yet come. This is one phrase that you would constantly see in this gospel. You will see that in John chapter 7, verse 30, in chapters 8, verse 20, chapters 12, verse 30, and a few more in the latter chapters. And this would always pertain to what? It would always pertain to the death and resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. He said, my hour has not yet come. Now, how was this statement connected to the predicament of the shortage of... In the earthquake. Okay. How was that statement, my hour has not yet come, connected to this predicament on the shortage of wine? One way of looking at it is that Jesus' utterances would often be symbolical. No, he would often utter words with symbolical meaning. Since the prophets had depicted that the coming of the Messiah as a time when the wines would flow profusely, this is basically a prophecy being fulfilled. Look at Amos chapter 9, verse 13 to 14. It says there, behold, days are coming, declares the Lord, when the plowman will overtake the reaper and the treader of grapes, him who sows seed. When the mountains will drip sweet wine and all the hills will be dissolved. Also, I will restore the captivity of my people Israel, and they will rebuild the ruined cities and live in them. They will also plant vineyards and drink their wine and make gardens and eat their fruit. Now, for us to better understand what Jesus said in verse 4, I took a quotation coming from John MacArthur. Mas maganda yung pag-paraphrase niya tungkol dito. And let me share you what John MacArthur said about this verse in verse 4. This is what he said. Sabi niya, what Jesus is saying is, look, we don't have anything in common because I'm now on a divine schedule that culminates in my death and everything leads to that. Every event, every issue, every circumstance is leading to that final hour. That final hour of my death and resurrection is set by God, and all events that lead up to that are determined by God. And this is what he told his mother
you are outside of that divine timetable. Now, if you are the mom, I'm sure masasaktan ka, di ba? You might be offended. It really could be offensive to a mother. But you know what? Because Mary already knew who the Lord Jesus Christ is and the purpose of His coming, instead of being offended, she simply took it into her heart. Look at how she responded in our last verse, in verse 5. His mother said to the servants, "Whatever He says to you, do it. Do it." I will basically end with this verse. And Pastor Dennis next Sunday will give to us the main gist of this miracle, turning water into wine. But let me expound further on this verse before I end and let you bring home something that you can meditate and ponder as you put into application all these truths that you've heard. You see, dearly beloved, the response of Mary by telling her servants to do what He tells you to do was more than a mother's experience of knowing that her son is reliable and trustworthy or dependable. You know what? It was actually a response of faith. It was a manifestation of belief. And this started as early as when it was revealed to her that she was to carry in her womb the Messiah. A belief that she carried for 30 years as she took care of her son Jesus. And this is the faith that enabled her to respond in belief, even if Christ seemed to respond to her request negatively. And this is one example of Mary that I believe we should emulate. You see, as of verse 5, the water were still water. The water was not yet transformed into wine. But you know what? Even without witnessing that miracle yet, we've seen how Mary responded in faith. The only thing that she was holding to before this miracle was what the angel said to her about the Messiah. That was what she was holding to. It is true that none of us have ever witnessed Jesus turning water into wine. Wala naman tayong nakaabot kay Jesus eh. None of us have ever seen Him personally perform any miracle. But you know what? All of these miracles, they were already revealed to us. Where? In the Holy Scriptures. Everything that has been said and done by the Messiah have already been recorded in the Bible by first-hand witnesses. These miraculous accounts of the Lord Jesus Christ happened for a reason. And what is that reason? So that the elect might believe. It was written for the elect. Look at what Jesus said in verse 11. And this is where I will end. "This beginning of His signs Jesus did in Cana of Galilee and manifested His glory, and His disciples believed in Him." Now, it doesn't mean that the disciples then who were with Him were still in unbelief. Hindi po ganun. But rather, it was for the purpose that their faith might be confirmed and strengthened. It was for the purpose that the glory of Christ might be shown to them. It was for the sake of the elect, for those who would believe. Now, if you would look at the other side of the fence, those who have witnessed these miracles and yet remained in unbelief, this can only confirm one thing. And what is that? Damnation. Damnation. It was a confirmation of their damnation. Why? Because they have already seen it, but they still do not believe. And so as we end, dearly beloved, for those of you who have been encouraged and convicted by the messages that were being preached on this pulpit, and this has brought you into repentance, then you know what, my friend? That is a confirmation of your faith. Because Jesus said in John 15 that if we remain in Him and His words remain in us, we so prove ourselves to be His disciples. But, meron akong but. If Sunday after Sunday, you sit on that chair and you listen to what the preacher is saying from this pulpit and even nodding your head in agreement and yet refuse to repent and kept indulging yourselves in that favorite sin of yours, my friend, that is your current, that is treading on dangerous grounds. If that is your current spiritual condition, delikado yan. You are treading on dangerous grounds. Because just like the scribes and the Pharisees of Jesus' time, they have witnessed all of these miracles and the wonderful things that Christ did, the messages that He preached, and yet they remained in unbelief. If we are like them, then you might end up like them also, being condemned. Being condemned. That is why we have to come to the Lord and humble down ourselves and ask Him to give us that ability to obey Him. Let us pray. Panginoon, salamat po sa gabi, sa umagang ito. Indeed, Your word is true. Your word is pure. Your word is perfect. It pierces the heart of those that are truly Yours. The heart of those that are truly obedient to You. Help us, O Lord, to live out everything that we have learned from Your word this morning. And may we truly be a shining light to others who are still lost in their ways. Bless us, O Lord, with all of these truths that we have learned. Enable us, dear Father, to obey You and follow You. Why don't we spend a few quiet moments and ponder on these truths that we have heard this morning?